गुड मॉर्निंग डियर चिल्ड्रन, सो वी आर गोइंग टू कंटिन्यू विद पार्ट फोर ऑफ द चैप्टर इशू ऑफ शेयर्स. इन दिस पार्ट वी विल स्टडी द फर्दर कंसेप्चुअल एंट्रीज एंड लॉजिक्स ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ विच वी विल बी डूइंग फर्दर प्रैक्टिकल क्वेश्चंस. सो द फर्स्ट टॉपिक डिस्कस्ड इन दिस वीडियो इज द ओवर सब्सक्रिप्शन ऑफ शेयर्स. इफ यू रिमेंबर इन द प्रीवियस टू प्रीवियस वीडियो वी हैड डिस्कस्ड अंडर सब्सक्रिप्शन ऑफ शेयर्स. दैट मीन्स व्हेन द number of subscribed shares are less than that of issued shares. But in case of oversubscription, it means that number of subscribed shares exceed the number of issued shares. For example, if a company has issued 5,000 shares, but while applying, it receives the application money for, let's say, 6,000 shares. So this is the case of oversubscription. Now, as we can read here, shares issued by well-managed and financially strong companies often get oversubscribed. Shares are said to be oversubscribed when the number of shares applied for is more than the number of shares offered to the public for subscription. So that means when the subscribed capital or subscribed shares are more than the issued shares, that is the case of oversubscription. However, as the company cannot allot shares more than that offered for subscription, the board of directors will have to allot shares on pro rata basis. It means now, it is since the company can allot shares equivalent to the number of shares it has actually issued. So in case of oversubscription, when the subscribed shares are more than the issued shares, it is at the discretion of the company. Either it can entirely reject the oversubscribed shares, or it can do the partial allotment, which is known as pro rata basis. Proportionately, it can allot the number of shares. It means that smaller number of shares are allotted to each applicant according to the number of shares applied by him. Suppose if I have applied for 5,000 shares, so instead of allotting me 5,000 shares, the company can allot me only 3,000 shares. Like this. There may be some applicants who are not allotted any shares. That means there might be some shareholders or some share applicants, I would say, not shareholders. Their money might be rejected overall. The application money received from these applicants is returned to them. Now, when the partial allotment is made, then we are adjusting the excess money received over the allotted share. So in that case, accounting will be a little bit different, which we'll be discussing further. But just now, there may be some applicants whose application is rejected totally. They are not allotted a single number of share. So in that case, their application money received from them should be returned back to them, for which the entry will be as given here: share application account debited to bank account. This will be just the reverse entry of the receiving application, and this entry will be passed with the amount which is actually rejected and returned to the share applicants. Here we are debiting share application, because when we had received this application money, we had credited share application, and now since we are returning the money, therefore by this returning amount, share application account will reduce. So therefore we are debiting share application account, and since the money will be going out, therefore we are crediting to bank account. Narration can be for application money received. When some applicants are allotted smaller number of shares, that means pro rata basis, partial allotment, the excess amount received on applications is utilized toward the amount due on allotment. Just like I was giving you an example, that suppose if I have applied for 5,000 shares, the company has allotted me only 3,000 shares. So while applying for the shares, let's say the application money to be paid was 3 rupees. So on 5,000 shares, I would have paid 3 rupees. That means 5,000 into 3, that is 15,000 I would have paid at the time of application. But instead of accepting or allotting entire 5,000 shares, the company has allotted me only 3,000. It has done partial allotment with me, pro rata allotment. So 3,000 into 3, that is 9,000 is okay. That is adjustable during application only. But the excess money which I have paid to the company on excess of 2,000, that is out of 5,000 shares, 3,000 have been allotted to me. So that means I have paid excess application money on 2,000 shares. So 2,000 shares into application money of 3, that is 6,000 rupees. So that means this excess 6,000 rupees with the company which I have made while over subscription, the company can utilize this excess money of 6,000 rupees while adjusting the allotment and further calls. So while calling the allotment money and calls money from me, the company will not be calling this 6,000, it will be adjusting. It is something like my reserve is there with the company. And for adjusting it in case of allotment, suppose my entire 6,000 is being adjusted during the allotment itself. So in that case, the entry will be share application account debited with the excess money, that is 6,000, to share allotment account. That means entirely 6,000 have been credited here. So while here I have already, or the company has already credited the share allotment account with the excess money, that means while receiving allotment from me, this 6,000 will not be received further since it is already there with the company. Sometimes it happens that money is so much in surplus with the company that it is adjustable not only in allotment but also in calls. So in that case, if the money, excess money is adjusted in the calls, then we use the word, or we open a new account, that is calls in advance account, and we'll do the treatment just like we have done for calls in advance. So as you can see, sometimes the excess application money exceeds even the money due on allotment. So such amount has to be returned. However, it can be retained by the company for its utilization towards future calls if the articles so authorize. So that means excess money cannot be adjusted in the calls unless and until it is mentioned in the articles of association. Usually the prospectus contains a clause to this effect. If the amount is retained, that means if the amount is further adjusted in calls also, it must be transferred to calls in advance account by passing the following entry. That means share application account debited with the excess money to share allotment account with the amount which is to be adjusted in allotment to calls in advance account with the amount which is to be adjusted in calls. How these will be calculated, it will be made clear to you when we do the practical question. So just now we are doing the entry. The ration can be for excess application money utilized for allotment and calls. Now, treatment of surplus application money in case of prorata allotment. Number one, if the question is silent about the treatment of surplus application money or states that surplus application money will be adjusted only on allotment, then surplus application money will be used only for allotment and the balance is still left will be refunded. That means, as we have discussed just now, that the surplus money or excess money received on application can be adjusted in allotment as well as calls in advance calls, but it can be adjusted in calls if and only if the articles of association permits the company. So this point, this note is saying that, so this is point, this is the point which is saying that if the question is silent, that means whether the application money, excess application money is to be adjusted in calls or not, if the question is silent regarding that, or it is specifically stating that surplus is to be used only for allotment, for adjusting allotment, and excess is to be rejected. So in that case, the entire amount after adjusting the application, excess application money in allotment, the remaining balance will be refunded to the applicant. Second point says, if the question specifically states that surplus application money will be adjusted towards allotment and calls, then the surplus application money is transferred to allotment and calls in advance account. The balance, if still left, will be refunded. So second point is saying, or we can say the summary of the second point is that excess application money will be adjusted in calls if and only if it is specifically mentioned in the question, and if there is any surplus still left after adjusting in allotment as well as calls also, then the excess money will be refunded to the share applicants. Then opening of joint application and allotment account. Sometimes it happens that the question asks you to open a joint account for application and allotment. So in this case, you will not pass the separate entries for application and separate entries for allotment. Rather, you will be passing a joint entry for application and allotment. So as you can see, nowadays it is becoming a common practice to open only one account for application and allotment instead of two separate accounts. In such a case, a joint account named application and allotment account is opened, and all entries relating to application and allotment are made in this account. When a joint account is maintained, the journal entries are recorded in the following manner. So on receiving the application money, the entry will be earlier we used to pass the entry bank account debited to share application account, but in this case we will pass the entry bank account debited to share application and allotment account, because we are opening up a joint account for the both the installments, and the amount will be number of shares applied into application money per share. So the logic is the same, but just instead of using the term share application, we'll use the joint term share application and allotment money, allotment account. On transfer of application money and allotment due. Now, in this case, we'll pass a same entry with the combined amount of application money transferred and allotment money due, because entry will be the same here. Share application and allotment account debited to share capital account, number of shares allotted into application money per share plus allotment amount per share. That means number of shares allotted will be multiplied with both the total of application and allotment money. Then on refund of money on rejected applications, if any, the entry will be share application and allotment account debited to bank account. That is number of shares rejected into application money per share. That is the same entry, the same logic. The only difference is, since here we are opening a joint account for application and allotment, therefore we'll write share application and allotment account. And then the next one, on receipt of balance of allotment money, that is after being adjustment, bank account debited to share application and allotment account. Here we are just using the joint name. Now, very important topic, children, forfeiture of shares. Forfeiture word basically means the cancellation. So sometimes it happens, you have already studied about calls in arrear. That means when a company calls up certain amount on shares, but the shareholder fails to pay such amount. So that amount is known as calls in arrears. And the company keeps on calling the calls in arrear amount again and again till a specified period. And if still the shareholder is unable to pay the calls in arrear account, it is at the discretion of the company. The company, by giving notice, can forfeit by issuing a last warning, and even after the last warning or the notice, the shareholder is still unable to pay the calls in arrear, then the company can very well forfeit or cancel the shares of the shareholders, and it can retain the money which have been paid so far. For example, if I am a shareholder and if I have paid the application money and allotment money, but I failed to pay the call money, first call money, let's say, and instead of getting a number of notices and everything, I did not pay the calls in arrear of the first call. So the company can forfeit or cancel my shares, and the money which I have already paid to the company, that is money on application and allotment, it will be retained by the company itself, it will not be given back to me, and my shares will stand cancelled. And whenever the shares are forfeited, whenever the shares are cancelled, in that case we use the term forfeiture, share forfeiture. Now, if any shareholder fails to pay the amount due on allotment or on any call within the specified period, the directors may cancel his shares. This is called forfeiture of shares. It may be noted that shares can be forfeited only if the articles of the company or articles of association of the company allow them to be forfeited. That means for forfeiture also it should be mentioned in the articles of association, otherwise the shares cannot be forfeited or cancelled. In order to make the forfeiture valid, it is essential to follow the rules laid down in the articles. If no rules are given in articles, then the provisions of Table F of Schedule 1 of the Companies Act 2013 regarding forfeiture apply. That means the rules regarding the forfeiture, the assumption, everything should be mentioned in the articles of association of the company. But if the rules regarding forfeiture is not mentioned in the articles of association of the company, then the company can adopt the provisions of Table F of Schedule 1 of the Companies Act 2013. The usual procedure is that the defaulting shareholder must be given a minimum of 14 days notice requiring him to pay the unpaid amount on his shares together with the accrued interest thereon. The notice must state that if the unpaid amount is not paid within a certain period, his shares shall be forfeited. If in spite of this notice the shareholder still doesn't pay the unpaid amount of his shares may be forfeited by a resolution of the board of directors. So that means the general rule regarding the forfeiture is that a company needs to give a 14 days notice to the shareholder that within these 14 days you better pay the calls in arrear calls in arrear amount, and it also has to state in the notice that if the shareholder is not able to pay the calls in arrear within the notice period of 14 days, then the shares will be cancelled. And if the shareholder still doesn't pay the arrear amount in the 14 days, then the company can cancel or forfeit his shares by passing a resolution by the board of directors. After the forfeiture, the name of the shareholder is removed from the register of members. The amount already paid by him belongs to the company and is not returned to him. So as soon as the shares are forfeited, shares are cancelled, our share capital will reduce, will decrease, it will be debited because number of shareholders is decreasing. The name of the shareholder will be strike out or removed from the register of the companies or register of the members. The amount which is already paid, as I was giving you an example, that if I have paid the application and allotment money, then it will be reserved or it will be retained by the company. It will not be refunded to anyone. So entries on forfeiture of shares. So shares may be issued, as we know, shares can be issued at par or premium. It can be issued at discount, but only sweat equity shares. So forfeiture of shares, the entry will be different when the shares are forfeited but they were originally issued at par, or when the shares are forfeited but they were originally issued at premium. So the first case is forfeiture of shares which were issued at par. That means the issue value and the face value was the same. On forfeiture of shares, the share capital is reduced. As such, share capital account is debited for the amount which has been called so far on the forfeited shares. That means share capital account will be debited in case of forfeiture entry, because the capital reduces with the cancellation of shares, and share capital will be debited with the amount of called up value. Calls in arrear account is credited in order to cancel the debit balance of calls in arrears account standing in the books. So we know that we credit the calls in arrear account when we actually receive the money, so as to close it. But whether we receive the money or we cancel the shares, calls in arrear account needs to be closed, and therefore it will be credited in the forfeiture entry as well. Then the amount already paid by the defaulting shareholder is credited to share forfeiture account. So whatever money was earlier paid by the defaulting shareholder will be retained by the company, and it will be transferred, it will be credited to a separate account, that is a share forfeiture account. Hence the entry will be share capital account debited, number of shares forfeited into called up value per share. This is very important. We'll debit it, but with the called up value. And remember one thing, children, share capital, wherever we are crediting or wherever we are debiting, it has to be debited or credited with the face value and never the premium or the discount value. So share capital account will be debited, number of shares forfeited into called up value. Two, calls in arrears account, amount not received on allotment and calls, that means whatsoever the amount is still pending to be received. Two, share forfeiture account, that is amount received on application, allotment and calls so far. Whatever amount has already been received, it will be credited to share forfeiture account. Whatever amount could not be received, it was called up but it could not be received, will be credited to calls in arrears account. And whatever is the called up value of the shares cancelled will be debited to share capital account. So this is the entry for forfeiture of shares issued at par. For example, Gopal was holding 100 shares of 10 each of a company on which he had paid 3 on application and 2 on allotment, but could not pay 2 on first call. If the shares of Gopal are forfeited by the directors, the entry for the forfeiture of shares will be share capital account debited with the called up value on defaulting shares, that is your called up, what is the called up value? 3 on application. No doubt the face value is 10, but you have to see how much was called up. If the installment is to called up as application, allotment, so no doubt the face value or the issue price of the shares is 10, but the company is calling till now only 7 rupees, that is 3 on application, 2 on allotment and 2 on first call. Rest of the call the company is not making. Therefore, share capital account will be debited 7 rupees, that is the called up value on defaulting shares, that is 100. So 7 into 100 makes 700. Two, calls in arrears account. This account will be credited with the amount which was not paid by the shareholder. So 2 rupees on first call was not made or paid by the shareholder Gopal. So 2 rupees on 100 shares, that means calls in arrears will be credited by 200 rupees. And two, share forfeiture account. So share forfeiture account will be credited with the amount which is already paid by the defaulting shareholder. So Gopal here has already paid 3 on application and 2 on allotment. That means 5 rupees he has already paid on 100 shares, which makes 500. So the entry for forfeiture in this example will look like share capital account debited 700, two calls in arrears account 200, two share forfeiture account 500. And as the narration, you can write for 100 shares forfeited for non-payment of first call of rupees 2. Second case is forfeiture of shares which were issued at premium. So if the shares were issued at premium and if they are being forfeited, there may be two cases: when the premium money is received and shares are forfeited, or when the premium money is not received and shares are forfeited. So the first case is when forfeiture takes place after the premium money is received. So when the premium money is received and shares are being cancelled, in that case, premium will not be refunded or written back. It is kind of a capital profit for the company. According to Section 52 of Companies Act 2013, if premium has been fully collected, it cannot be cancelled even if that share is forfeited later on. As such, securities premium reserve account will not be debited in the entry forfeiture in this case. And secondly, when forfeiture takes place before the premium is received, that means when a share is forfeited on which the premium has become due but has not been received either wholly or partially. In that case, the securities premium reserve account must be debited with the full amount of premium in the entry forfeiture, because in this case we need to write back the amount which we had credited to premium reserve account. In this case, the entry will be share capital account debited, that is again amount called up so far excluding premium. As I already told you, share capital will always be debited or credited with the face value only. Securities premium reserve account debited if the premium has not been received. If the premium is received, then we will not debit securities premium reserve account. Two call scenarios. Again, amount not received on allotment and calls including premium if it is not received. Two share forfeiture account, that is amount received on application, allotment and calls so far. So the narration you can write for forfeiture of shares issued at premium. For example, X Limited issued 100 shares of 10 each to Gopal at a premium of 4 rupees per share. That means 10 is the face value and 14 is the issue price. Only 3.5 rupees per share have been received on these shares on application. Gopal has not paid 6.5 rupees on allotment including premium of rupees 4. And 2 on first call and 2 on final call. That means Gopal has made payment only for the application and rest he could not pay and his shares were forfeited. So entry for the forfeiture of above shares will be share capital account debited with the called up value. That means the entire calls were made. So 100 shares into 10 each excluding premium, that is 1000. Securities premium reserve account debited with the amount of premium on defaulting shares, that is 4 on 100, that means 400. Two call scenarios, that is amount not received on allotment and calls including premium. So that means 6.5 of allotment, 2 of first call and 2 of final call. That means 10.5 rupees were not received on 100 shares. So that means call scenarios account will be credited with 1050. And two share forfeiture account with the amount actually received on application, allotment or call so far. So in this case 3.5 on application was received, so it will be credited to share forfeiture account. 3.5 into 100, that is 350. So this is the entry for forfeiture of 100 shares which were issued at premium and premium money was not received. In the above case, the amount of premium was due on allotment. Gopal could not pay the amount due on allotment and as such he could not pay the amount of premium also. Hence the securities premium reserve account will be debited in the entry for forfeiture. If it would have paid, he would have paid the premium, then we would have not debited the premium reserve account. For example, if in the above example number 2, it is assumed that Gopal had paid the amount of application and allotment as well, and only calls are not received from him, the entry for the forfeiture of shares will be as under. Share capital account debited with the called up value excluding the amount of premium, that is 10 on 100 shares, that means 1000. Two call scenarios account, the outstanding amount on first call and second call because he paid the application and allotment. So as we can see, 2 rupees on first call and 2 rupees on final call he did not pay. Therefore, call scenarios account will be credited with 4 rupees on 100 shares, that is 400. Two share forfeiture account will be credited with the amount which he has already paid. And if he had paid the premium amount also, then that too we will not credit the share forfeiture with premium, we will just credit it with the face value. That means 3.5 of application and 2.5, that is excluding premium of allotment, that is 6 rupees on 100 shares, that means 600. Now the reissue of forfeited shares. Directors have the authority to reissue the forfeited shares on such terms as they think fit. That is to say that they are at the liberty टू रीइश्यू द फॉरफीटेड शेयर्स एट पार, एट प्रीमियम और एट डिस्काउंट. इफ द कंपनी इज रीइश्यूइंग द फॉरफीटेड शेयर्स, द कंपनी कैन रीइश्यू द फॉरफीटेड शेयर्स आइदर एट पार और प्रीमियम or discount. And if the companies are reissuing the forfeited shares at discount, then in that case the maximum amount of discount which they can give is the amount which they have already retained at the time of forfeiture, that means which they have credited to share forfeiture account. However, if the shares are reissued at a discount, the amount of the discount cannot exceed the amount previously received on these shares. For example, if a share of rupees 10 on which 3 has already been received is forfeited and reissued, minimum 7 must be collected on its reissue because 3 has already been retained. It means the maximum of 3 can be allowed as discount on the reissue of such shares. Following entries are passed on the reissue of forfeited shares. Number one, if the forfeited shares are reissued at par, now whenever the shares are reissued, the entire money is paid or called up at once. So when the shares are reissued at par, the entry will be bank account debited to share capital account. The logic behind is money will be deposited in the bank account of the company, so bank account will be debited, and since the shares are being reissued, the share capital will increase, therefore we'll credit the share capital account. If the forfeited shares are reissued at premium, the entry will be bank account debited with the amount received to share capital account to securities premium reserve account. There will not be any transfer or due entry. When the forfeited shares are reissued at discount, we'll debit the bank account with the amount actually received, and instead of using the word share discount or anything, we'll transfer the amount from the share forfeiture. So we will debit share forfeiture account to share capital account. That means whenever the forfeited shares are reissued at discount, the amount or the loss on account of discount is to be adjusted from the amount which is already retained on forfeited shares in share forfeiture account. When we retained the amount, we credited the share forfeiture, and when we are adjusting the discount amount, we will debit it. After the reissue of forfeited shares, the credit balance left in the share forfeiture account is a capital gain to the company and must be transferred to capital reserve account. So after all the forfeited shares are reissued, any amount which is still left on such reissued shares in the share forfeiture account will be treated as a capital gain and will be transferred to capital reserve account. The entry in such case will be share forfeiture account debited, because we are closing it, to capital reserve account for transfer of share forfeiture account to capital reserve account. It should be clearly understood that if all the forfeited shares are not reissued, only that proportion of share forfeiture account which belongs to the reissued shares should only be transferred to capital reserve account. That means if 100 shares are forfeited and out of 100 shares only 80 shares are reissued, so only amount left on 80 shares, reissued shares, will be transferred to capital reserve and rest will be transferred only when these are actually reissued. So I hope the topics discussed in this video is clear to you children. Just go through the video once again, revise all the entries and the logic behind, and especially the notes which have been explained to you to be remembered, because in the upcoming video we'll be discussing the practical questions on this topic. So this is the assignment. Based on this part, you have to answer the following questions in your register. Question number one, give the entries for adjusting surplus money towards allotment and calls at the time of oversubscription of shares. So in this case, the entry for adjusting the surplus money in case of allotment will be share application account debited to share allotment account. And for adjusting it in calls, the entry will be share application account debited to share allotment account to calls in advance account. Second question, give the entry for rejecting share application money at the time of oversubscription of shares. So the entry for this question will be share application account debited to bank account. क्वेश्चन नंबर थ्री, गिव द एंट्रीज ऑन फॉर फ्यूचर ऑफ शेयर्स when issued at par and issued at premium. So when the shares are issued at par, the entry for forfeiture in this case will be share capital account debited with the called up value on forfeited shares, two calls in arrears account with the outstanding amount on forfeited shares, two share forfeiture account with the amount actually received on forfeited shares. In case of premium, there may be two cases when the premium money is received. In that case, the entry for forfeiture will be share capital account debited with the called up value excluding the premium on defaulting shares, two calls in arrears with the outstanding amount excluding premium, two share forfeiture account with the amount retained excluding premium. And when the premium money is not received, we need to write back the premium amount. So we'll pass the entry share capital account debited with the face value on the defaulting shares excluding premium, securities premium reserve account debited with the amount of premium on defaulting shares, two calls in arrears account with the amount outstanding on defaulting shares including premium, two share forfeiture account with the amount retained on forfeited shares. Question number four, give the entries for reissue of forfeited shares when reissued at par, at premium and at discount. So when the shares are reissued or when the forfeited shares are reissued at par, the entry will be bank account debited to share capital account. When the forfeited shares are reissued at premium, the entry will be bank account debited to share capital account to securities premium reserve account. And when the forfeited shares are reissued at discount, the entry will be bank account debited, share forfeiture account debited to share capital account. So these are the questions which you need to do in your register and revise all the previous parts. In the upcoming video, we'll be discussing practical questions on this. Thank you, children. Take care.